Good morning, and welcome to worship at Grandville United Methodist Church. My name is Ryan, and I'm the pastor. And this morning, I join you from virtually from a church beautifully decorated for Pentecost, the celebration commemorating the arrival of the Holy Spirit. This morning, Reverend Rachel May will share with us the story of Pentecost, showing us how recognizing the two different theys in the story acts as a call to action to all who believe across the generations. I hope you are blessed and challenged by God's word during this time of worship together. And now let us join our hearts and voices together in our call to worship. Praise the Lord, from whom all blessings flow. The day of Pentecost has come, and we have gathered together in this place. We are nothing without you, O Lord. Send forth your presence and grant us your mercies and love. Creator God, rain down your spirit that we too may prophesy. Praise the Lord who sends forth his spirit. Praise the Lord who renews the face of the earth. Jesus Christ, rain down your spirit that we too may see visions. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. Everlasting Father, rain down your spirit that we too may dream dreams. Praise the Lord. Amen. And now let us join together in singing our opening hymn.
You were born? Probably not, because you were just a little tiny baby.
Well, today we get to hear the story of how the church was born. Unfortunately, no pictures though. They didn't have cameras back then.
Let's take a look at the Bible and get started. First, Jesus sent his disciples to tell the world about God.
After Jesus died on the cross and rose again, he went to talk with the disciples. He told them something very important, that they needed to go tell the world about him. He wanted everyone to hear about him, so they could put their faith in him and spend eternity with him.
So they all traveled to different places to tell the world about Jesus.
Did you know that Jesus tells us to go tell the world about him too? Then, Peter's first sermon surprised everyone.
Do you know Peter the disciple? Well, everyone back then knew he was just a regular old fisherman. So they were really surprised to hear him preach a sermon.
He went from catching fish to preaching to a huge crowd. Can you believe that? It was very surprising to see Jesus use a regular guy to do great things.
Did you know that God wants to use you in big ways too? Next, the early church grew faster than anyone expected.
On the day that Peter gave his first sermon, 3,000 people became Christians. That's a lot of people.
That was probably a super exciting place to be. Memory verse. All the believers were united in heart and mind.
All the believers there became really close to God and really close to each other. Did you know that God wants us to grow closer to Him and our Christian friends?
Everyone who believes in Jesus is part of His church. We put a big capital C in church because we aren't just talking about your church.
We're talking about God's church, which is every Christian in the whole wide world.
Even though when none of us were alive, when it was born 2,000 years ago, we can still be a part of it today.
It all started because a few people went out and told people about Jesus.
And Jesus wants even more people to be a part of his church and know him.
So kids, go out there and tell more people about Jesus.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning. All this I have told you, so that you will not fall away. They will put you out of the synagogue. In fact, the time is coming when anyone who kills you will think they are offering a service to God. They will do such things because they have not known the Father or me. I have told you this so that when their time comes, you will remember that I warned you about them. I did not tell you this from the beginning because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me. None of you asks me, "Where are you going?" Rather, you are filled with grief because I have said these things. But very truly, I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you.
There are 2 days in the Pentecost story, as it is told to us by the book of Acts. There's the they, T-H-E-Y, of verse 1. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And then there's the they of verse 7. Amazed and astonished, they asked, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? The first they that are all together in one place, refers to 100 and some followers of Jesus. They're in Jerusalem because the risen Jesus has told them they were not to leave. The second they, that is the crowd who gathers and is bewildered by the sound of at least 15 different languages spoken at once, refers to the various groups of religious folk that are in Jerusalem for a festival, because that's just what you did 3 times a year. So there are 2 days in the second chapter of Acts. With a few exceptions, both theys, both crews are Jewish, which means that the they of verse 1 and the they of verse 7 have more in common than we may be accustomed to imagining. If they speak different languages, it's because they have had to. They identify as Galileans, Parthians, Elamites, and so on, because the Hebrews haven't been the Hebrews, or the Israelites haven't been the Israelites for hundreds of years. They've long been scattered. So yes, there are 2 days, but this is not a duel. It's more like a family get together on a holiday where strange things happen and relatives say the darndest things to each other, and it is not at all uncommon to accuse or be accused of showing off, drinking too much, or being just plain crazy. When suddenly from heaven there comes a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and fiery halos appear above the heads of each of these Jesus followers, the remarkable thing about it is not that the Galileans, the they of verse 1, are suddenly shouting garbled nonsense. It's that the 15 or so other groups, the they of verse 7, understand exactly what's being said. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. If we're going to talk about the day of Pentecost as a miracle, it's a miracle of hearing or communication. Those who are filled with the Holy Spirit communicate clearly. And when these others who are there ask, what does this mean? They don't need a translator. They need a rabbi or a spiritual director. This crowd is devout, the text tells us. They're asking, what does what just happened mean for the way that we see the world and our place in it? At which point, Peter realizes it's time. It's his turn. And though not a rabbi, nor a priest, nor an authority of any kind in the traditional sense, Peter puts himself between the 2 days of Acts chapter 2 and tries his hand at preaching. Christians say that this right here is our birth story. We associate ourselves with the coming of the Holy Spirit into a particular room around the year 30 AD. Peter preaches this sermon and off to the races we went. Something entirely new happens at Pentecost. At least that's what I keep hearing. And what I want to do with this sermon is ask, is that really the word of God for the people of God? The new thing that happens grows up out of the old. Of that we can be certain. If you and I are going to talk about Pentecost as a miracle, we may need to consider that the miracle may be one of hearing or communication. That's not the same thing as speaking in tongues, which is taken up elsewhere in the Bible. If Pentecost is a celebration of a miraculous moment in our sacred past, we may also need to ask ourselves if the miracle is the fact that we exist. The Spirit descended upon the apostles, thousands of people converted. Christ's church was born. Is that the long and the short of it? If you've ever spent a good deal of time around a person who only finds something meaningful, to the extent that they can relate it back to themselves, then you know that this way of being in the world can be an issue. This person or this part of any one of us sifts through a story or a meeting for self-advancing nuggets. Hearing Pentecost and thinking, yay, church, is like that. I'm not convinced that this happy birthday us business reflects a deep listening for the Word of God. I think it may be symptomatic of a community that listens primarily for what we can put to immediate use or make instantaneous sense of, as though God's story is not in and of itself worthy of beholding. Two book recommendations, if I may: Fresh Air by Jack Levinson and Knowing the Holy Spirit Through the Old Testament by Christopher Wright. They have guided me to a place of seeing what isn't brand new about Pentecost. And here's the thing, my parade hasn't been rained on, not in the least bit. In fact, I have never loved this story more than after having heard it told from some unusual starting places. Peter, according to Acts, starts with the words of Joel. Standing in between the two theys, he says, "These that are with me are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel." Church folk often start with Jesus. Jesus died, Jesus rose from the dead, Jesus ascended and told the disciples to wait in Jerusalem for the coming of the Holy Spirit. If I start with Joel, I can tell you where I'll land. The meaning of Pentecost is that the thing that Joel said would happen, happened. And if I start with Jesus, I land in a similar spot. We celebrate Pentecost because on that day, the Holy Spirit came like Jesus said that it would. I want to start with Simeon. Not because I'm too cool for school and not because I've deemed myself the co-author of Acts. I want to start with Simeon because I believe the author of Acts gives us permission to. The one whom God inspired to write Acts and the one whom God inspired to write the Gospel of Luke are one and the same. Simeon is the one in Luke who takes the Christ child in his arms. Jesus has just been born. His parents have brought him to the temple. We're told that Simeon is there, and not by accident. The Holy Spirit has brought him there. The Holy Spirit has told him, Simeon, that he will encounter the Messiah. The Holy Spirit is upon Simeon. Simeon does the customary thing. In priest-like fashion, he acts as the go-between, connecting God and God's people through a ritual. He begins to sing, and it's the content of that song that contributes to the story of Pentecost. He sings about the saving grace of God and how it is spilling over the walls of Israel. The babe in his arms is a light for revelation to the Gentiles. And because the Holy Spirit has orchestrated this moment, you and I are presented with a possibility that one has to do with the other. That the Holy Spirit is somehow related to God's mighty acts of salvation, reaching out to embrace all people, not just the chosen one. Which is precisely what Isaiah had said hundreds of years before Simeon. The Holy Spirit action in the beginning of Acts recollects the Holy Spirit action in the beginning of Luke, and the beginning of Luke recollects nothing if not the hope of the prophets. Isaiah in particular, who proclaimed the coming of the Spirit-anointed servant of the Lord. Simeon, looking into the eyes of the infant Jesus, is hearing the prophetic poetry of the one who 500 and some years before had promised, "All of the earth shall see the salvation of our God." With the Holy Spirit upon him and Jesus nestled in the crooks of his old man elbows, Simeon sings to God, "My eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples." Simeon knows that Jesus will take the part of the servant of the Lord, the Spirit-anointed servant described by Isaiah. Simeon can feel it in his bones. Jesus will be the one that will restore Israel to God's mission. What I'm trying to say is that the miracle of Pentecost has to do with God's mission. God's mission since Abraham has been to bless all nations on earth with and through those who live their lives in service to God. Be it the first families of the faith, the Hebrews, the Israelites, the Spirit-anointed servant. Jesus took up the mission. He took on the role of the Spirit-anointed servant to the nations. At Pentecost, the mission and the role of the Spirit-anointed servant to the nations becomes ours. Will the world, like Simeon, see us as precious evidence that God has once again made a way? Will our neighbors sing because we are an embodiment of heaven's tireless pursuit to stretch God's saving grace over all corners of the earth? The miracle of Pentecost is that it's possible.
And now let us sing together our closing hymn. And now receive the benediction. Go forth from this time of worship to live lives of worship, to rejoice in the gift of the Holy Spirit, strengthening you and guiding you on your journey, to rejoice in the Holy Spirit's call on your life as well, to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, and to live out your God-given potential in every moment. Go forth in grace and peace, to love and to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.